So let's get into Ra. Last time we began and went into Card 7, the Great Way of Mind, sometimes called the Charioteer. Ra explains that this Great Way of Mind, it reflects and summarizes archetypes 1 through 6. So all that mind processing, the potentiated conscious mind, processing catalyst, using it for polarization, providing oneself with a qualified or refined experience, you know, experience that makes sense to us as part of our spiritual path. That leads to a recognition of true mind significator. That leads to a further clarification of who's your beloved, you know? Are you on the path of love, or are you on the path of, you know, rank selfishness? And that determination of path moves to the Great Way. The Great Way is the way of living as an integrated mind-body-spirit, more or less, on our path. Ra says, the Great Way of Mind shows the kingdom or the fruits of appropriate travel through the mind. And that's, again, a point I made last time. We think we're in space and time, but we're really in mind. Ra said, you are dancing thoughts. You do not, you know, you're not living in a material universe. You are dancing thoughts. That is some recognition of shunyata, or emptiness, or insubstantiality, meaning flickering light does not indicate materiality. Just because your hand can't go through the wall doesn't mean it isn't thought or it isn't mind, because it's only known and experienced by mind. So this is travel through the mind. When we have, you know, as we do now, somewhat. So the kingdom or the fruits of appropriate travel through the mind, in that the mind continues to move as majestic, so the mind is moving, you see. The mind, or our consciousness, moves as majestically through the material it conceives. We're only conceiving this, you know. This world is our conception. It's the dream of the Creator and the dream of ourselves, made into a happy dream or a nightmare, you know, both. Moving majestically through the material it conceives as a chariot drawn by royal lions or steeds. Ra is saying, when studying, this is page 46, I'm reviewing, when studying the archetypical mind in general, we may suggest that the student look at the Great Way of Mind, card 7, this one, not as that which is attained after contact with intelligent infinity, which is really to understand, you know, polarization after we make contact and find ourselves, at least initially. It's not about that, although it's analogous to that, but rather as that portion of the archetypical mind, right? It's just a nodal point in the deep mind here, which denotes and configures the particular framework within which mind, body, and spirit archetypes move. Meaning that in general, cards 7, 14, 21 represent the framework in which we develop. It's not the same. It's a nodal point, an archetypal bias in deep mind of 3D. Not the same as us as an entity, but it's analogous. And it relates to the overall movement of mind or body or spirit, these seventh position cards. So Don asked about the veil and the curtain. Ra says that the purpose of this card is to limn the milieu, or to illuminate the framework, the context in which we are living. And so the Raw says the veil is shown on the cart, somewhat lifted and still present, so there's still some veiling, since the work of mind and its transformation involves progressive lifting of the great veil betwixt conscious and deep minds. That's very important, progressive lifting of the veil. Progressively we see and know more. The complete success of this attempt is not properly a portion of 3D work. So don't assume we should, you know, become Buddhas or fully enlightened in 3D life. But, and more especially, the complete success of lifting the veil, you know, unifying conscious and unconscious, is not a product of 3D mental process. You can't think your way to freedom. There has to be the presence of all-embracing love, not just wisdom thought. Ra indicates that the third density experience is skewed or distorted so that the positive orientation has more aid than the negative. This is a little complicated. On the last card, Ra was saying that the negative is protected by their power, and the positive way has not the same protection, basically, of aggression as the negative path involves, so that there seems to be less protection, but there's greater higher protection. Your protection is somewhat or essentially composed of the angelic choir or the symphony and the chorus of greater beings that are with us, positive beings. So Ra gets into further a discussion about the veil and limited viewpoint, and that's Kapha 47. Very interesting. Ra says the polarities are both dependent upon a limited viewpoint, meaning being veiled. However, negative polarity depends more heavily upon the illusory separation between self and all others. Ra said, betwixt self and all other mind-body-spirit complexes. So the negative polarity, those on that path, depend on illusion, as I've said before. This is a primary cause of their entropy or loss of power, and their inability, their failures. The positive polarity, on the other hand, attempts to see through the illusion to the Creator in each mind-body-spirit complex and in all, but for the greater part, positive path is concerned with behaviors and thoughts directed towards others in order to be of service. This attitude in itself is full of the stuff of your 3D illusion, because it's full of the stuff of a chronic committed belief in duality. You know, we have a lot, you know, why do we resent others if we've given too much or they don't listen? Because we believe that talking to them, even though they're not listening, is more important than being in peace silently or doing what we want. Maybe you want to talk to them, but it's also possible to simply be to be in silence and realize that the greater service is sharing your wholeness, sharing your peace, or being open in peace. Anyway, our illusions, which are many, are the basis of both paths, because again, you know, the whole notion of creation is just a concept. The Creator discerned a concept called finity. The fact that everything appears to us as limited or finite is simply the result of misperception, limited perception. So Huxley said, if the doors of perception were cleansed, man, we would see, you know, reality as it is, infinite. Very, very, he knew that from drugs, but it's a metaphysical truth that it's the cloudedness, the turbidity, the obstructions of perception that lead us to the perception we have now, which is limited, which doesn't see eternity, which doesn't see infinity, which doesn't see forever in the display of light. We see the dancing light, but we don't realize that it's one light dancing. And so we think it's all a thing, separate from other things. It appears separate, or finite, but what is its true nature? So then we get into the new material. Any questions? That summary took 10 minutes, and we can move right along. All right. Anyway, anybody, in general, thank you, Billy. In general, if you have a question, you know, just jump in, okay? Just say, I have a question. So, otherwise, we'll move along. So, now we get into the, you know, discussion about the symbols of the card. Don asks about the crown of three stars. And on the card, there doesn't seem to be any stars, because he was talking about a version of this card or a tarot deck that's not the same as what's shown in the final version here in Book 4, or from Book 4. The images we're using are not the same as what Don was using some case. So, what about those stars that were there? Don asked if they represent balancing of mind, body, spirit. Ross says, this device, meaning the imposition of the three stars or crown of three stars, this device is astrological in origin and the interpretation given somewhat confusing. Sorry. We deal in this image, rather, meaning the image of the great way of mind, with the environment of mind. Okay, so the environment or context of mind development is called the great way of mind. The context or environment in which body is developed, which really means etheric and chakras and energetic, not like, you know, muscular development, but development of body is the development of the energy substrate of mind. That case, card 14, Great Way of Body, also shows the environment of the development of body, which is really energetic. So card 7 represents then the context in which that element, mind, body, spirit, develops. Ross says then it's appropriate to release the starry crown from its stricture. That means don't worry about that image. It's not important because it's astrological. So again, you know, there's an implicit valuation of astrology here as less important than the archetypal design of the logos for 3D evolution. So, you know, astrology is in the main underrated. Among those who know it, it's overrated. Welcome to humanity. So, next question. Don's asking about the small black or russet and white entities on the bottom, saying they've changed. Now they appear to be sphinxes, yes, to the lower right left, which we are assuming that the catalyst has been mastered. His assumption. He's also assuming, Don, that they, the two figures, act as the power that moves the chariot depicted here, so the mastery enables the mind in its transformation to become more mobile. That's reasonable, right? The mind is moving along. Now we get Ra. Ra says, well, firstly, we ask that the student consider the great way, this card, not as the culmination of a series of seven activities or functions, which is what I've been doing. So I get a rap too here. Don't consider the Great Way card as culmination of a series of seven activities or functions. All right, it's not just one thing that comes after that, but as a far more clearly delineated image of the environment within which mind, body, or spirit shall function. Again, we're talking about card 7 or position 7, 7, 14, 21, the Great Way cards. Being seen as a more clearly delineated image of the environment in which a mind or body or spirit functions. Therefore, the culturally determined creatures called sphinxes do not indicate mastery over catalyst. All right? That's fine. So, then, the second supposition that Don made, that of placing the creatures as the movers of the charity of mind, has far more virtue. Ah, okay. So, it's not mastery of a catalyst. You know, people, everybody is such in a hurry to be finished with everything, you know? I'm done. It's gone. I finished it, right? Ra says, the second supposition, placing creatures as movers of the chariot of mind, has far more virtue. You may connote, or get a sense of the concept of time to the image of the Sphinx. So there's, you know, a movement over time. The mental and mental-emotional complex ripens and moves and is transformed in time. Time is in your mind, of course, but in the experience of time, which seems physical, linear, and substantial, mind and mental-emotional complex, or mind, is able to ripen, move, and be transformed. Ripen. So again, a vegetative image of that which becomes ripe, right? It's not a hard fruit that's not ready. It's not a rotten fruit. It's a ripe fruit. And so the ripening of mind, and that's a term used by some Buddhist teachers also, ripening. It's a very nice image. The gradual maturing development into a condition of full potential, you know, and sweet taste. So further, Don asks a long question about the sword and the scepter, what he thinks it is. I don't want to read Don because at this point it's a little too complicated. Ra says about the scepter and sword, these symbols are astrological in origin. The shapes, therefore, may be released from their stricture. The stricture is our mind trying to hold it and fit it into interpretation, or make interpretation, and fit it into our understanding of the card. That shouldn't be done, or it's not necessary, because the astrological basis is less important. You know, astrology says a lot, but it's not pivotal, it's not core to an understanding of how the logos programmed these points in the deep mind. That was not astrological. It's logoic. So you can see how, as the original tarot, as a teaching tool for Egyptian initiates, straight from late 60, was degraded into a reflection of the astrological. So it's a movement actually from monotheism to polytheism. Astrology is basically a Trojan horse for polytheism, or a rejection of the belief in one love, one light, one life. One love, light, one love, one light, one life. This all is one life. Now, same has happened in Catholicism with the movement from appreciation of the Father, the one Father, which is what Yeshua talked about, if there was a Yeshua, moving into the pantheon of saints. Oh, it's a feast day. Oh, we have another saint. Ah, the saint of fishermen. Ah, the goddess of this and the god of that. It's the same old crap. Humans not appreciating the one creation as, nor appreciating creation and all as manifestation of one being, but rather dallying themselves in the many, deifying form, deifying function, rather than appreciating universal purpose. It's universal purpose that is the one point divine plan from the one infinite, the source of all. That has been forgotten, and of course that's part of Orion, their plotting, so that humans keep their eyes on the many rather than the one, and then fight themselves because they don't appreciate the one higher self or the unity of our being. So the descent from many, from one to many, is Orion inspired, and it leads to a thorough blanketing, a greater blanketing, curtaining away the higher self. You know, the gateway to appreciation of unity is embrace of true nature. True nature is unified. Creation is unified. The way to see the unity of the creation is to realize the unity of the self. Now. Not that it's something to be made. What's made is the elimination of obstruction. The work is removing falsehood, not creating the real. But astrology, for all of its good value, unfortunately is used in the service of overvaluing manyness and forgetting the one, that this is one, this situation, this creation, and one is one based on a singular purpose. The original desire is that entities seek and become one. Right? The original desire is that entities seek and become one. That's one desire from one source. The manyness is trivial. And so a focus on many gods, many deities, many things, many saints, leads to confusion among the many elements of mind. And so that's what I wrote in the essay Self and God. As we conceive God, so do we conceive ourself. As we conceive ourself, so do we see God. So as seen within, so seen without. As conceived within, so conceived without. And perception and belief come from perception. Perception is guided by belief. You know, there's a circularity to that. As we think of ourselves, so we think of creation and others. And as we don't see within, we don't see without. True, also. Anyway, Ross says, we may note that there is an overriding spiritual environment and protection for the environment of the mind. So there's the environment of mind, which is really soul, actually, meaning multi-incarnational consciousness stream and field. Multi-incarnational stream and field is the context of mind. There's a greater overriding spiritual environment and protection to that too. You see, the human environment is dangerous, but the creational environment, multidimensional, is protective. You know, put your faith in the one. But it's not faith, it's really knowing that you're not alone. And creation is a lovely place. It's just humanity that's all messed up. Ra goes on, we may further note that the negatively polarized adept, okay, now we're talking about 3D negative and above negative, the negatively polarized adept, right? So there are negative adepts, right? What do you think those black magicians are? They're negative adepts. They will attempt to fashion, you know, they just love it, you know? They'll attempt to fashion that covenant, interesting word, that covenant for its own use, meaning the environment of mind, whereas positively polarized entity may hold forth that which is exemplified by the astrological sword, that is, light and truth. Okay, so sword indicates light and truth. The ability to cut through, the ability to pierce, the ability to define and delineate. That's function of wisdom, finding living in truth. The negatives, on the other hand, manipulate it, you know? They fashion the context for their own use in gaining more power. They just love it, you know? It's just their way. You can't stop that. They want to be that way. Going on a little further, Don asks further about the T square. This T, or is there seems to be a strange figure, actually a T, which is very interesting. It's sort of an ankh without the top loop on the charioteer's chest, torso, front, in the zone of third chakra to fourth chakra. Again, it looks like a cross, but it's actually a T square and two L's. Anyway, that strange figure in the middle of his chest involves a T-square, and it does represent a move, you know, the option of right and left. So Ra, Don asks, you know, what does it have to do with? Does it have to do with choosing the paths in your transformation? The two options. Ra says, the use of the Tao from Taurus. Tao is the T, the root of T. Personally, I'm a Taurus, so I like Tao a lot. The use of the Tao and the architect square on the chest, on the third, fourth chakra zone of the charioteer, is indeed intended to suggest the proximity, of the space-time of the Great Way's environment to time-space. Okay? So, the proximity or the intimacy between the environment of mind that we recognize and the environment of mind that's invisible, they're near to each other. Meaning, this is, you know, really esoteric, because we're not talking just about how we're, you know, us living on Earth in 3D space-time. We're talking about the configuration, the logoic configuration of the deep mind as it develops in its relationship or its interplay between space-time and time-space. So it's the context of mind development as that development partakes of a blend of physical and non-physical environment or physical non-physical attribute, meaning conscious mind and deep mind, what we see and what we don't see. We find this observation most perceptive. Again, the relation between the context or the environment by which mind develops and that interplay of space-time, time-space. Ra says, the entire mood of the Great Way, card 7, is indeed dependent upon its notable difference from the significator. Now we're getting deeper. The significator, which is card 5, is the significant self. Who's your significant other? Who's your significant self? Right? So, he is my significant other. Well, who's your significant self? Speechless response, I would imagine. The significator is the significant self, to a great extent, but not entirely influenced by the lowering of the veil. So this is the difference between fifth ray and seventh ray also, right? The Great Way of the mind, the body, or the spirit, card 7, 14, 21, draws the environment, which has been the new architecture. Okay, so this is a change, a development from cards 5, or position 5 goes through 6 to 7, or, you know, same thing with body and spirit. 12 goes to 14, 19 goes to 21, The fifth position goes to the seventh. The seventh position, or great way of mind, body, or spirit, draws the environment, meaning it configures or offers the environment by which a new architecture, caused by the veiling process, and thusly dipped in the great limitless current of time-space. This position 7 card, whether it's card 7, 14, or 21, the great way cards of mind, body, spirit, draw, which is interesting. Draw means to pull forth. Draw means to etch or, you know, set down in the graphical form. It generates, let's say, or it brings forth card, this position 7, this great way, brings forth an environment which has been the new architecture, or becomes, it really is a new architecture, that's caused by two things. One is the veiling of mind, which is what we're dealing with, that has then been dipped in a great limitless current of time-space. And that's the point, that's why the Tao is used in the third chakra position. Third chakra is under the veil, like under the diaphragm. Third chakra mind is different than the mind which has been infused with fourth and fifth ray activity, which is beyond the veil or in time-space. So that's the difference, which is interesting, because card 5 or significator, the essence of mind or body or spirit, is the result of, you know, an interplaying dynamic. Where that goes further then is a substantial or a structural revision. The nature of the conscious mind is changed by its self-chosen potentiation, you know? By seeking, the seeker is transformed. By seeking, we enter the realm of the limitless current of time-space. Seek and you will find. What you find is yourself. Or more of your being, or your being, which is not a more or less, but it's a totality. Then, the result of that is that the one that sought is changed. Who's seeking anyway, by the way? Who's seeking? Who's speaking? Who are you? You're not the body. You're not the contents of the mind. You're not your energy fields. What is you? What is I? It's not a theoretical question. It's very practical and related. And so, the one that seeks is transformed by the seeking, because the seeking will lead to finding. And the finding will lead to expansion of the seeker. But the seeker is intangible. Who's talking? Who uses body? Who uses mind? Who? What? What uses mind? That's the case. That type of reflection, thought, is associated with the Great Way card, or a great way nodal position, not the significator. The significators are really just the heart of body or mind or spirit. The great way seventh position cards really represent substantial transformation of the significator, and that's the point. So, let's see, we're a page and a half before the end. We could finish it today if you want to take 10 more minutes. Okay, I can get into it next time then. That's fine. It's heavy stuff, and sorry, my presentation, my voice gets strong when I talk, which is my enthusiasm. All right, so that'll be all for today. Next time we'll finish the Great Way card, and that'll leave us on page 50, which begins the cards of body. So that's nice. The PDF is 70 pages, and we're one talk away from page 50. So we're moving right through it. So anyway, let's stay in touch, everyone, and feel free to send me email or whatever. And we're still on for 2 weeks from tonight, which is July 2. And have a good evening. And see you next time. So good night. Have a good sleep. Thanks again. And see you next time. Bye.